Welcome to Hindu Analysis, September 19, 2018. So today we are going to cover all these articles. So the first article is China raises tariffs on $60 billion goods of US. So what the news here is, it is mainly dealing about the trade war which is happening between the world's largest economies, which is the US and the China. So the recent news is US has imposed 10% tariff on the goods which is worth $200 billion which is made in China, and it is coming to force from September 24 onwards. So if you see the background of the imposition of tariffs of US and China over each other, so this is the background. So first, from the starting of this year, that is from January, US first imposes tariffs of 30% and 20% on solar cell and washing machine imports, and then it extended its tariff like 25% and 10% on steel and aluminium imports from all the countries including China. And later China retaliated by slapping $3 billion US imports by means of imposing tariff. And again, US accuses China for the theft of technology, and it again put $34 billion Chinese imports under its tariff. So Chinese again trying to retaliate it. So again, US is putting like $16 billion of imports over China, and China again retaliated by putting tariffs of $16 billion. So it is continuously happening in the recent times. So what the recent news here is, US is imposing its 10% tariff on Chinese imports, right? So what it actually state, that is what is the US point of view here is, it is stating that China had a policy which is made in China 2025, and under this policy, whatever China is doing, it is by means of through stolen technology, and it actually violates the Beijing's market opening commitments. So Beijing has some market opening commitments, but now it is not like that. It is not going in that way. It is violating that, and it is also China is making use of stolen technologies. This is what the US stated at first. And also China is following improper industrial policies as well as unfair trade practices all over the countries. So stating these two things as China's negatives, US is imposing this 10% tariff on Chinese imports. And it is also planning to increase this tariff from 10% to 25% by the end of this year, that is 2018 itself. It will reach nearly 25%, because why now it is 10% and after some time it will become 25% means this time gap is allowing the US companies to adjust to their supply chains to alternate countries. That means whatever the countries which is now depending on the imports from China, now the US is giving some time for that companies to take some kind of alternate countries to get the resources apart from China. So for that time period only, it is now putting 10% and it is planning to increase to 25% in the future. So what China is now telling is, that is the news, that is China is now trying to impose the tariff on $60 billion of US products. Okay, so this is the news. Why? Because China said it has no choice but to retaliate against the US tariff. That is what China tells. And what is the China's point of view here is, it is to curb the unilateralism which is followed by US and the protectionism of the US. So protectionism attitude. America is first. That is what the US policy, right? So in order to curb that, in order to make multilateral trading system, and in order to ensure free trade all over the world, US is, China is telling that we are retaliating by means of imposing tariffs on US products. Okay, so the next article is, a child under 15 dies every 5 seconds around the world. So this is stated by United Nations. So the United Nations World Health Organization, these international organization recently conducted a survey, and from that survey they come to a conclusion that it stated that in 2017 itself, the data says that nearly 2.5 million newborns died in their first month itself. That is, the first month of every baby is the most risky period of their life. So in that period itself, nearly 2.5 million newborns are died all over the world, and nearly 5.4 million deaths in the first 5 years of their life, and 6.3 million children dies under the age of 15 itself. So by means of stating all these facts, what they are concluding here is, for every 5 seconds, each children under 15 is dying. So that is what they are stating. So from these data, what they found is, the children or the newborns, that is the first month newborn babies, right? So the sub-Saharan African and the South Asia, in that region only the newborns dying is 9 times more than the high income country, and the sub-Saharan African children are 15 times more vulnerable than the children in the Europe, and they have the more risk of dying. Okay, so similarly, under 5 mortality rate, if you see in all over the world, the under 5 mortality rate, it is more in rural areas than in urban areas. It is twice that of the urban areas in rural areas. And the most shocking fact here is the children of uneducated mothers, they have the probability of dying more than the educated or the mothers who are having their secondary or the primary education. So the uneducated mothers' children are more vulnerable, and they, because they are not having awareness to take care of their children's health, right? So because of that, it is more, they are more vulnerable than the educated mothers' children. So these are all the facts which is derived from the data by UN. So if you see in this picture, the sub-Saharan African region and the South Asian region. So these are all more vulnerable to the risks of dying children under 15. Okay. So if you see the reasons behind the death, that means why the children are dying all over the world. So the main reason is even the children are getting affected by preventable and treatable causes, because of the lack of proper health treatment, they are dying. So the complications during birth, pneumonia, diarrhea, neonatal sepsis, as well as the malaria. So these are all the diseases which are preventable and as well as curable, but because of the lack of treatment, they're dying, right? So this is first major thing. So the second major thing what they're stating is the children between the 5 to 14 years of age, they are mostly vulnerable to the injuries. That is, the injuries are the prominent cause for their death, and the injuries is mainly due to the drowning and the road traffic accidents and etc. So these are all the reasons why the death rate is more under 15 children. Okay, so if you see in this picture, it is 2016 data. So it is indicating the deaths per 1,000 live births. Okay, so for every 1,000 children, how many children are dying? So if you see in India, it is 15 per 1,000 stillbirths that is dying, and 21 neonatal, and 28 days to 1 year children, like 10 per 1,000, and 1 to 4 year children, 7 per 1,000, and under 5 children, 39, that is 40 per 1,000 children are dying. So these are 2016's India's data related to under 5 mortality. Okay, so what is the way forward here is, even though the number of children, that is the under 5 mortality rate, is reduced from 12.6 million to 5.4 from 1990 to 2017, there are still the concerns, that is still the children are dying all over the world, right? So we have to take the steps in order to curb or eradicate the mortality of the children to complete to its entirety. So without urgent action, if you are not taking any immediate measure, then it will result in dying of nearly 56 million children by the end of 2030. So it is a major concern. So also we all knew from this fact that who they are and where they are born. So this is the major deciding factor for the children's health and their children's survival. So we should change that. We should give them adequate medicines, clean water, electricity and vaccines, because these are very simple solutions. If we provide all these things to them, then we can easily eliminate or curb this under 5 mortality itself to its core. So the next article is IMF estimates real depreciation of Indian rupee, and that is 6 to 7% only. So what the news here is, from the starting of this year, all the emerging market currencies are getting depreciated against US dollar, and if we calculate in terms of depreciation of our Indian rupee against US dollar, it is estimated to be 11% loss. Okay, so $1 equal to 73 rupees, right? So it is, from the starting of this year, it is loss, it is losing like 11%. But the IMF spokesperson, he is telling something which is the real effective depreciation of the rupee. That is, not only the Indian currency is depreciating against the US dollar, all other emerging market economies' currency is also getting depreciated. So if our currency is alone depreciating, it is 11%. That is correct. But all currencies are depreciating, right? So if you calculate in par with all the currencies, then it is only 6 to 7%. So this is what the IMF spokesperson recently told. So he also telling that the prices of the imported goods such as oil and the petroleum products from the Gulf countries, we are mostly relying on the import of the oil and petroleum petroleum products from Iran, Saudi Arabia, those Gulf countries, right? So that in future potentially put an upward pressure for the inflation in Indian economy. So this is what he recently stated. And he also spoke about something which is the two transitory disruptions in the recent year. What are the two transitory disruptions? Means one is the GST, another one is the demonetization. So we all knew that it is not that much up to the level, but instead of telling the negative things, he's also telling some positive things, the positive impacts of these two things. One is this demonetization enhanced digitalization as well as higher formalization of our Indian economy itself. And the because of the GST, the revenue under tax compliance is also growing. And there is a growth in the number of the new taxpayers. The tax base is now getting expanded. So these two things are the recent achievements because of these two, GST as well as the demonetization. This is what he said. And he also raised a positive note that the growth has been gradually accelerating in the recent quarters, and both the consumption and the investment is also strengthening in the Indian economy, as well as Indian economy is recovering very strongly. So this is what he tells. Okay. So the next article is India targets slight increase in 2018-19 food grain output. So what the news here is, the Indian government actually targets the production amount of rice and wheat, like 113 million tons rice and 100 million tons wheat, which is slightly higher than the previous year's harvest. So previous year it is like 112, but now 113 they are expecting, and 99 it is 100. So totally from 284 million ton it is targeting 285. So it is a slightly increase in the production harvest target than last year. But if you see in case of maize, coarse cereals as well as the pulses, it is slightly lower than the last year harvest what they are expecting. Okay, so these are all the production capacities of our country. So the next article is banking on mergers. So this article deals with the recent news where the Bank of Baroda, Dena Bank as well as the Vijaya Bank, these three banks are going to join together as a single entity. So the government recently announced this proposal of an amalgamated entity, which is nothing but the merging of these three banks. So why we need to merge these banks means to handle the bad loans crisis in the bank. So if you see in this picture, the weaker bank is merged with the stronger bank in order to become even more stronger. So this is what they actually aiming at. So this stronger bank is providing some kind of money, some kind of advices and some kind of policies or everything to the weaker bank, so that weaker bank is recovering from its NPAs or from its bad loans. Okay. So by means of merging all these three banks, it will become the country's third largest lender. The first one is SBI, the second one is HDFC. So by means of merging, what they're actually aiming is, if some banks are getting merged, then they should not recover the capital support from the government. Instead, they should circulate the money among themselves and they should help each other. They should complement each other. These all banks should complement each other and try to recover from the bad loan crisis and all. So it should not recover money from the government. That is what the main aim of this this merging and all. So in this case, these two banks, that is the Baroda and the Vijaya Bank, is going to help the Dena Bank to recover from its crisis. Okay. So if we see in the past, already last year, State Bank of India is merging with its subsidiaries of five branches and with the Mahila Bank, right? Similarly, LIC of India is also taking over the IDBI Bank, which was in very troubled condition, and it helps IDBI Bank to recover from its crisis. So this is also in line with that. So that even though it looks good, even though the merging looks good, but it is having certain concerns, like this kind of forced mergers of these banks together makes the little business sense. That is, it is making little sense for the stronger banks, because anyway, by means of merging, only the weaker banks are going to get benefited out of this, not the stronger banks, as well as it is going to drag the operations of the entire entity itself. So it is a concern for stronger banks, and it is unlikely to solve the bad loan crisis. We are not sure that by means of merging we can easily solve this bad loan crisis and all. It is not sure. It is also in a question. Similarly, government being the dominant shareholder, they are dictating the critical moves, and it is impacting the minority shareholders. Even though the bank is having some kind of other shareholders, but the government being the dominant shareholders, it is only unilaterally telling its moves without considering the views of the other shareholders. So it is also again a major concern. What they are suggesting is, Merger is one way or other way, it is very good. It is helping to manage the bad loan crisis problem. So we cannot discount it entirely, but at the same time, we should not end up creating bigger bank or a bigger amalgamated entity, which is weaker than the original pre-merger stronger bank. Before itself, the stronger bank like Bank of Baroda, it is good, but by means of this merging, it should not weaken that bank itself. So it is, we have to ensure that this is what the major concern we have to focus on now. This is what they stated in this article. So it is, if you see in this, by means of merging, the positive results can be achieved in terms of business, deposits, net NPA and CASA ratio, but in terms of employees, because a lot of nearly 85,000 employees are working in all these three entities, so it is going to affect the, that is what they stated from this data. And if you see in our country, there are nearly 21 nationalized banks, and now by means of this merging, it is reduced to 19 banks. So even it is a larger amount, so we have to consolidate even further to make the function efficiently. So the next article is Celestial Misfit. So it is talking about whether the Pluto, which we assumed as a planet before, but now it is not, right? So it is a planet or not. So this is what the article deals with. So in 2006, IAU, which is the International Astronomical Unit, they voted to remove Pluto's planetary status. That is, Pluto is not a planet anymore. It is a dwarf planet. That is what they stated. And they, that is what they stated. It is a dwarf planet. So what is a dwarf planet means? It is a celestial body. Celestial body means all the stars or all the planets and comets, asteroids, whatever present in the universe, right? So those all are the celestial bodies. So any celestial body which is resembling a small planet, it is the dwarf planet is also a smaller planet, but it is lacking certain technical criteria to be a planet. So that is what the dwarf planet. So we are going to see what the criteria in a moment. So if you see the Ceres, which is in the asteroid belt, and Xena, which is in the Kuiper belt. These two are the dwarf planets, okay? So this Xena is in having icy ring of frozen objects that circle around the solar system. So it is Pluto. So if you see in this picture, it is Uranus and it is Neptune, okay? Neptune's orbit, and it is Pluto's orbit. Okay, so between Neptune and Pluto, apart from beyond Neptune, whatever present, it is the comets or the belt which is present, it is called Kuiper belt. Okay, so beyond Pluto, whatever present, that is called Oort cloud. Okay, Oort cloud. So this is Kuiper belt, and beyond Pluto, it is Oort cloud. So we have seen, right, that is, to be a planet, it has to have some kind of criteria. So there are three criteria. One is the planet should, that is, it must orbit the sun. And the second one is it should have the massive enough to occur an approximately spherical shape. That means it should orbit the sun, first of all, and it should have some kind of mass to be in a spherical shape. The third one is it has to clear its orbit, so which means the object that exerts, that is, it should be the object to exert maximum gravitational pull within its orbit. So in this orbit, it should be the dominant one. So then only it is called the planet, which means any other object, any asteroid or comet which is attacking near this planet, if it is comes near that, because of this maximum gravity, it should send it away or send it back to the outer space. This is what the third criteria. So it is clear, it should clear its orbit, it should be dominant in its orbit. That is what they stated. But what about Pluto means? The third criteria is not getting fulfilled by the Pluto because it didn't clear its orbit. Why? Because it is affected by the Neptune's gravity. So in its orbit, Pluto should be dominant, but it is not the case. Neptune's gravity is affecting the Pluto. It is one thing. And if an object ventures closer to the orbit, if an object coming to the orbit, it will either collide with it, or it would be accreted, or it should be ejected away. It is also not doing by the Pluto. Any object can easily interact or come into the orbit of Pluto. So by means of this only, they reject Pluto as a planet, okay? And also Pluto shares its orbit with the frozen objects in the Kuiper belt. So in the Kuiper belt, which is between Neptune and Pluto, in the Kuiper belt, there are certain objects, right? So they are also sharing the same orbit with the Pluto. So these are all concludes that Pluto did not have achieved its third criteria. So only it is not a planet. It is what stated by the International Astronomical Unit before. So if you see in this picture, it is Kuiper belt and it is Oort cloud. So Pluto is somewhere here. So what the news here is, whatever the technical criteria to be a planet, it is now under question by a planetary physicist who is Philip Metzger. So what he stated is, the clear your neighborhood or clear its orbit, the third criteria to be a planet, right? So that is seemed ridiculous and it is technically flawed. So we all knew that planets are very simple, that is, they are round objects which are in the space that are smaller than the stars. If any round object which is smaller than star, it is planet. This is what the simple definition. We have to go or we have to abide by that definition instead of this technical definition. This is what the recent physicist he stated. And if Pluto is not a planet, similarly Earth is also not a planet, because like 500 million years ago, Earth is also orbited among a swarm of debris instead of revolving in a particular orbit, fixed orbit around the sun. It is revolving like a swarm of debris, and only recently it started following this orbit. So if you follow the same technical criteria to Earth, then Earth is also not a planet. And similarly, if you take Earth today and if you move the Earth to some kind of asteroid belt which is after Mars, so if you move it to that place, then Earth ceases to be a planet, right? But it is not true. So by means of stating this as an example, he is telling that the technical definition of a planet should be very simple and Pluto should be considered as a planet again. So this is what he stated. But what the issue here is, if you started accepting Pluto as a planet, then it will lead to similarly 110 planets in solar system. There are lot of celestial bodies which is having the same criteria as the Pluto, so it is also now coming as a planet. So it will become 110 planets in the solar system itself. And if you see Charon, which is the Pluto's moon, it is very large to be considered as a satellite. And so this Charon-Pluto system should be called as binary planet system, which led to the classifying other set of bodies also as the binary planets. So it is incoming, it is making even more number of celestial bodies to be considered as a planet. And the Kuiper belt and the Oort cloud, that is also having a lot of celestial bodies and objects which is having the criteria of the planets. So it is making the entire system of planet in the solar system as complex and complicated. So this is what they conclude in this article. So the last article is 10 years on in uncharted waters. So what this article talks about is the recent crisis in the emerging economies all over the world, that is all the emerging market economies are now in crisis, right? So this crisis shows that how much all the economies are depending on US, how much we are depending on US dollars, and how the change, even the slight change in the US economic policy is getting reflected in all the economies, all other economies. So this is what this article majorly talks about. So if you see the global economic crisis of 2008, it is mainly attributed to the failure of the regulation of banking system in US. So in US, the banking regulation is not proper. So that created a contagious effect all over the economies. So what are those regulation failures of US in the sense? The first one is the banks of US were allowed extraordinarily high levels of debt in relation to the equity capital. So any bank, it should have some capital called equity capital, that is, it depending on the capital it is having, in proportion to that amount only it should lend it to the people or the citizens or the corporates or whatever. So consider, for example, a bank is having like $500 billion, then it should lend in proportion to that only, it should give that much amount of equivalent of to its consumers or its customers. But the US in this case, the banking, because of the greediness, the banking system lend more than its equity capital, whatever its capacity, actually it is lending more than that. So that is one major reason for its failure. The second regulation failure is the banks in the advanced economies, that is in US, they moved away from making loans to investment. So instead of giving loan, now they prefer investment in complex assets called securitized assets. So before it was preferring giving loans, but now it is moving towards investment. So how it creates a failure means, so consider a housing loan scheme or something by government or any party, but now what the banks is doing is banks is investing or giving money to that housing scheme. Okay, so now this parties or the government should lend this money in a proper way. It should not give just like that. But what really happened at that time is, instead of doing it in a proper way, they are just like that, they are giving the monies to the customers, which in turn didn't give any kind of proper return to the scheme as well as to the bankers. So it is creating some replication effect, right? So it is also a major reason for the failure of the banks in US at that global financial crisis time. So these two are the crisis. So the third reason for the failure is the lenders to the banks are not retail depositors but short-term lenders. So the money which is made use by the banks, that is not from the retail depositors, instead it is from the short-term lenders in the wholesale market. So the short-term lenders means they are giving or lending the money only for a short term, and they want to realize the profit in a short term. If they are not getting the profit, they are going to withdraw the money back. But it is not the case in the retail depositors. They are actually looking for a long-term benefit, and they are not going to withdraw the money if it is not working. So dependence or over dependence of the short term fund by the US banks at the time is also a major reason for the or regulation failure for the global economic crisis of 2008. So these all shows that the board of banks and their regulation did not exercise adequate oversight. They are not having a long-sighted policy, they are only having a short-sighted policy. This is what they conclude from these kind of regulation failures. So before proceeding further, we have to know certain things. One is the global financial crisis of 2008. It is also known as the Great Depression, and it is began with the failures of financial institutions in the US. Because of the US financial institution failure, like the Morgan Stanley, Goldman Sachs, these are all the financial institution in US, and as they started to failing, that is we have seen before, right? So because of that, it evolved into a global crisis, which is resulting in a number of European bank failures. It is not only affecting their own economy, but it is affecting all other economies, especially the European and the Asian economies. Okay, so, and also one more concept, which is the currency convertibility. So currency convertibility means if you want to convert your Indian rupee into a dollar in order to buy goods and services or in order to buy some assets, that is currency convertibility. It is having two types. One is current account convertibility, another one is capital account. As the name suggests, current account means anything deals with goods and services. Capital account means anything deals with capital, like capital assets, bonds, shares, etc. So in case of India, if you see these two things, India has full 100% current account convertibility, but only partial capital account convertibility. Okay, so why? Because if we are giving full capital account convertibility, then the investors are going to invest more money in the developed economies by means of converting the rupees into dollars, right? So it is going to benefit other economies, other developed economies, and it is not going to reap the benefits for our economy. So only we are keeping the partial capital account convertibility as of now. Okay, so, and this is the major, this partial convertibility is the major reason why India is not getting affected during that global economic crisis of 2008. Okay, so if you see here, where the failures of global financial crisis of US is confined to US alone, or it is affecting other countries? No, it is also affecting other countries, like it affects the banks in Europe and some in Asia as well. And it creates a large chunk of problems in the entire global banking system itself. And it in turn creates a lot of job losses and outputs, as well as it further leads to the Eurozone crisis, Brexit and nationalism and the immigrant policy stringent rises and the new protectionism attitude followed by Trump. Everything is a consequences of that global financial economic crisis and whatever the lessons they have learned from that. Okay, so these are all negative things, right? And how did such a colossal failure of regulation occurs? And in the sense, as we already seen before, it is mainly due to the regulatory capture failure. They are not able to capture the regulation properly. And why? Because the financial institutions doesn't have the ability to influence the policies of the government or the policy makers or the corporates, etc. They don't have that much power to say. So that is one reason. And the revolving door syndrome, which means the bankers are hoping to jobs like government and regulation, and the government officials are going to get the jobs in banks. So this is revolving door syndrome. So this creates a kind of nexus among them, and it is in turn affects the proper implementation of the policies of the bank, in turn reduces the effective functioning of the banking system itself, and there is no accountability. And if you see the impacts on India, we are not suffered that much due to the financial crisis. And even though our growth has slowed down to 7%, but it is in line with the current trend. So it is not affecting that much, because as we seen before, how means India hasn't embraced that full capital convertibility. We are having partial, right? So that is also one reason, because we are having our money in our economy itself. We are not allowing our money to go into other economy. So we are having our money, and we are having even though the forex reserves also. So these helps to maintain the stability in our Indian economy at the time. and keep short-term foreign borrowers with the stringent limits. Even though the foreigners want to buy money from us, we are putting stringent limits so that the money from here to there is limited. And didn't open up to foreign banks. So these are all the things why we are not that much affected, okay? So what should be the key reforms? Means there should be a good improvement in the governance of the banking system, like reduce the dependence on the short-term borrowing, instead depend on the long-term borrowing, so the retail depositors, and reduce the incentives for taking excessive short-term risk. If a bank is going to take short-term risk, then reduce the incentive. It actually demotivates them to go for the short-term risk. So it is also one thing. And getting banks to have more equity capital. So you have to push or recapitalize the banks with even more equity capital. So these are all the reforms suggested by the author. So if you see, because of the US economic policies and how it affects other economy also, right? So what is the core issue means? Too big to fail problem. This is the first one. That means the banks are very large and it is not allowed to fail. So this is one thing. And second one is the size of debt of households and the non-financial firms is very big, which in lead to the drop in the household consumption. And the private debt, even though it is falling, the government and the corporate debts are rising. So these are all the concerns which was happening at that time. And welcome. So the third is the financial globalization, which makes the world even more vulnerable to the US monetary and fiscal policy. Not only globalization in terms of goods and services, financially also we are now globalized. So it is even more making all other countries to more dependent on US monetary and fiscal policy. And if any change in US policy, it will affect or it will have a ripple effect all over the economies. So how, which means how US handled that global economic crisis situation means, first, the US unleashes a flood of dollars at a very lower rate so that there is a surplus of dollars which is flowing in the economy, and the investors, the global investors, they are starting to get the money from US at a very cheaper rate. And instead of investing those money, so once the investors are getting money from US at a very cheaper rate, what they did is they started investing that money from US to other developing economies like China, India and all, okay? So now the money which is available at a cheaper rate is flowing towards the developing economy. So which in turn yield the benefits for the developing economies and not for the developed economy like US. So again, the US started raising its interest rate from the lower rate to the higher rate in the recent 2 to 3 years, okay? So what now happened is those investors or the global investors who are flooding towards the developing economy, now they are again coming back to US because whatever the reason, the stability of the financial situation in US is always stable despite of the political changes. Not like in developing economies where the political change is there, then obviously the economic policies is also getting changed in developing economy. But it is not the case in US. So because of the increase in interest rate, they again started flowing to US. Okay. So we all knew that the dollar is the reserve currency of the world. So what they are concluding here is economists are free to draw their lessons from the financial crisis, whatever happened in 2008. So from that, the economists as well as the policymakers, they have to draw some lessons, and we should go for some alternative global financial architecture. So that is what the need of the hour. So this is what they suggest.
Thank you.